Hello. So the next heading is called the death of character, postmodern slash ist drama, postmodern drama or postmodernist drama. Remember those two adjectives that we talked about, postmodern and postmodernist? Okay, those are the difference between the two. I hope you remember. If not, look it up and then come back to watch this video once again. So here the author says that performance art monologue that we discussed in the last video is postmodern historically, but it is not postmodernist. Okay, so it is an event that happened in that particular historical period as is defined by authors as being postmodern. Okay, but in its essence, it is not postmodernist. All right. In the 1983 essay by Eleanor Fuchs, The Death of a Character, she discussed a development that she considered to be the harbinger of postmodernism in theater. Okay. And this is a de-emphasis of the modern concept of psychologically consistent dramatic characters in favor of fragmented, flowing, and uncertain identities whose exact locations and boundaries cannot be pinpointed. So until then, the main characters or the other even subsidiary characters that we had in drama, okay, they were considered to be psychologically consistent. Okay, even though our Hamlet had some psychological issues that we keep discussing throughout our studies, all right. But other than that, usually all of the characters that we have seen were psychologically consistent. Okay, they had, even though Hamlet was not right in his mind, he had a particular identity. Okay, he was the Prince of Denmark. But in postmodern drama, okay, the death of a character, as Eleanor calls it, what happens is that in favor of those definite characters, it was not in favor of those definite characters anymore. Instead, we had fragmented characters, like, in the birthday party, the character, okay? So flowing characters, uncertain identities, you don't know who they are, where they come from, what are they trying to do, you don't know any of that. Okay, so this is considered to be a postmodernist phenomena, right? Performance art monologues posit stable, locatable identities. Okay, so postmodern performance art monologues, what they usually do, why is it called postmodern? Is because in those performance art monologue, you know who you are. That's why you're talking out. Okay, so it assumed to define the performer. Okay, and it does not represent the postmodern trend of pluralism. So even though it was looking into the soul of the performer, it did not come with the postmodern trend of pluralism of fragmented identities. And hence, the author says that it was historically postmodern, but not postmodernist. Okay, so the two plays that he discusses in this regard are Sham Shepard's Angel City, which was first produced in 1976, and Jeffrey M. Jones's Der Inka von Peru, okay, which was first produced in 1984. Now, please go and read this particular part in the text because, I'm not going to talk about the entire play here. It is important that you read what the author has to say. It's written in a very, very simple manner. So only from page 104 to 105, if you read that portion, you'll know what I'm talking about. Okay. So why he has chosen these two particular plays, he says, is because it gives us an insight into the status of a character in a postmodern drama. Okay. So what happens to a character in a postmodern drama is what we can understand when we read about these two plays, okay? He says that there is a disappearance of the individual subject. So the individual subject is not there anymore, okay? Rather, as we talked about, there are fragmentary identities, okay? So according to this, there was this idea that was put up by Frederick Jameson that you'll read up in this particular part. Before you listen to the rest of this video, please go and read that part and come back. Okay, so pause here, go read that part and come back. It's just one page, not even one page, I think half a page almost. Okay, so anyways, Frederick Jameson talks about pastiche, okay, which you must have heard about in your drama paper earlier. Pastiche is like parody, okay, the imitation of a peculiar, unique, idiosyncratic style, the wearing of a linguistic mask, speech in a dead language. Okay, so it is like a parody almost, but it's not parody in the sense that you're almost wearing a mask. a linguistic mask. Okay, you're using the mask of language to explore something. But it is neutral practice of such mimicry without any parody's ulterior motives. A parody's motive is what? To entertain or to poke fun at some particular aspect of society or a person. Okay, but pastiche is neutral. It does not have any such interesting ulterior motives. Okay, pastiche is thus blank parody. Okay, a statue with blind eyeballs, that means, you know, it has no purpose as such, but it is just, you know, there for the sake of it. That is what he talks about in this section. The next section is called a postmodernist approach to directing. Okay, so directing a play. Postmodernist directing, he says, okay, there are various modern approaches to directing which might be characterized as emphasizing the discovery of a central action and theme in a play. Okay, so the modern directing techniques are mostly those that deal with the discovery of a central action. Most of the plays that we discussed this semester did not make much sense, right? And to find the central action of the play or the theme in a play and then express them. That means when the postmodernist director is putting a play like Hamlet Machine on the stage, it's not just the actor and the costumes that he has to think about, everything from the backdrop to the music to be used to the entire, you know, the how to set up the entire auditorium as such is something that falls upon the head of the director. And in everything, okay, the essence of postmodernism should be there. All right. So what the director has to do is to understand what is the theme of this play. In Hamlet Machine, it is death and death and death and meaninglessness. So how does he, you know, express that through his art is something that is important. So that is what a postmodernist approach to directing is. All right. So you have to find the central action and theme in a play and express them through an appropriate and consistent production style. So that means you can't change your production style in the middle. Okay, it has to be consistent. All right. On the other hand, you know, there are other directors like Peter Sellars who show the postmodern impulse towards cultural collage. That means their directing is not, you know, consistent. It is almost like a cultural collage. There are a lot of things happening. Okay, so rather than seeking a play's interesting focal points, directors like Peter Sellars do are juxtaposing text and performance elements in various styles. That means they do not form a follow a consistent style. Rather, they juxtapose in the chal and the putting on top of one another, right? So it's almost like a collage. When you do collage making in your competitions, what do? There are lots of different images that don't necessarily go together, that are put together on a chart paper, right? Similarly, different types of styles, different type of texts are all brought together and these elements are mixed together like a collage, all right? So what does it do? It becomes a hybrid, okay? It becomes more than a play, it becomes a hybrid performance. And obviously, something that is not singular, something that does not have a consistent identity becomes automatically postmodern. Okay. Then our author goes on to the next section where he talks about postmodernism and stand-up comedy. You must all be familiar with stand-up comedy, I hope. It is a very, very popular form of entertainment now, right? So I hope you have listened to it at some point. If you have not been in a live show, you must have at least seen some videos, right? And I think there was a Malayalam film about a stand-up comedian, a woman stand-up comedian also. Okay, so this stand-up comedy, according to our author, is a diverse enterprise under postmodernism. It's a kind of a different performance altogether. Okay, when stand-up comedy began, it's not a postmodern phenomena, it existed through the ages, all right? So stand-up comedy actually was begun by men of Jewish heritage. It was Jewish men who used to stand and say these comic things, okay? And mostly people would laugh because, you know, they looked different. So it had more to do with their looks and their identity rather than with the things that they would say, okay? Then, you know, this heritage was passed on to African Americans, who again, same thing, the racial diversity is what was important there. And it is only in the current ages that we see women coming up, okay, as stand-up comedians. So this has become a kind of stage that was occupied by, you know, a certain community and now is open to even women. But the notion of comedy itself is problematic. What is comedy or what is funny? Okay, so there are two problems that our author points out here. He says that, you know, comedy itself became problematic under postmodernism because comedy by definition requires stable reference. It requires norms against behaviors. What is comic? Why was Charlie Chaplin funny? Because instead of walking straight, he used to walk in that funny manner. Right? So it has someone who is stable, someone who follows all the rules, someone, you know, who does everything that he's supposed to in the correct manner is not funny. It is only when Mr. Bean, you know, instead of eating his sandwich straight, he tries to, you know, put toothpaste on it or whatever. All right. So I forget, I cannot think of a particular episode. But why is Mr. Bean funny? Because he's not following the norm. He's not normal. Right? But how do you in postmodernism, we say that there is no normal, right? There is no normal, there is no central, there is no identity, a stable reference is not there. How then do you bring up comedy then? Okay, when there is no norm to be followed, how do you define comedy? In the absence of such norms, it is impossible to define comedy, as you might understand, right? Some comics responded by becoming meta-comedians whose performances took the impossibility of being comedian in the postmodern world. So what did they do? They did meta-comedy. Meta means one on top of the other, right? So what were they doing? So they, instead of, because they did not have a subject to talk about, what did they talk about? How difficult it was to be a comedian. And that itself became funny, okay? The second problem is, just as some postmodernist playwrights created dramatic characters as collection of fragmentary tricks, okay, just as we talked about in the earlier section, there was no one character, it was a fragmentary identity, okay, there's no identity. So just like, you know, playwrights were creating fragmentary texts instead of one central character, and, you know, rather than psychologically consistent beings, we had, you know, psychologically different people. Some stand-ups also eschewed the presentation of clearly defined comic personae. Okay, so what our comedians try to do is follow along the lines of these playwrights, and they also try to bring up, you know, they bring up characters who did not follow the norm, and yet, you know, instead of creating a solid character, they created a defined comic personae, okay, a kind of character that would be automatically funny without having to think of a particular person. Like, you don't have to think of Mr. Bean anymore for it to be funny, or Charlie Chaplin. You would create a fragmentary character who would be funny in any situation, right? Please read this portion in your text. This is page 107, where Steve Martin's comedy is described. So you'll understand this better if you read that part. Okay. The next subtopic here is representation in postmodernist performance. So we already talked about how pluralism was something that was completely postmodern. Okay. So here again, Peter Sellars is coming up, and what our author is trying to say is that the appropriationist playwriting and Peter Sellars' genre busting directing are examples of practices that one can describe to be both postmodern as postmodernist. That means stylistically also, historically also, they have postmodern elements. Nevertheless, both retain the basic procedures of modern theater. Okay, but, you know, they still, even though they are breaking all the norms, they are still following certain traditional practices. What are they? They are text-based, right? There is a text that is to be followed. Now, there is no, we have not reached a stage yet where there is no text at all. Okay. And they follow the play production performance model, in which a script is interpreted by a director. Okay. And it is explained to the actors who then perform this particular play. Even if the constituent elements in this process reflect postmodern culture, so even though the text may be postmodern, the style may be postmodern, the actors may be postmodern, okay, but still, you know, the traditional theater apparatus still remains constant, okay? So even if the elements in this process reflect postmodern culture and postmodern aesthetics, the process leaves the apparatus of modern theater unchallenged. So they are still following that modern theater elements, okay? So Then our author goes on to say that let's look at certain practices which are there, which challenge the authority of modern theatrical apparatus. That means that foundation that was there, okay, that was broken by certain practices. Let's look what they are. Okay, first example that is given is Living Theatre by Beck and Molina, okay, where it is a poet's theatre specializing in the production of rare works, okay, and they work directly without starting a play. That means, you know, there is no reading session where you sit around. If you've been in a play, you know that, you know, the one of the first pre-production stages is you sit around in a circle and you read the text together and then you decide who is to play which character. That there is no such kind of a process here. Rather, they go directly and they start a play. Okay, that means that reading itself is the play. The first time they will be reading it will be the performance. Okay, other radical examples are, you know, where, you know, the idea of a collective creation and the notion that theater did not necessarily begin with a script. Okay, that script was not needed, but it could depart from improvisation. That means when people are coming together, they can think of a script. They don't need to write it down, but rather they can improvise. It means, you know, talk instead of written down dialogues, they can just say what comes to their mind in that particular state in a context. Okay. These theaters, in turn, provided models for groups that emerged in the 1980s and 1990s, okay? And this kind of an approach where there was no script, but, you know, there was a lot of improvisation and ideas by the cast themselves, was often called devising, okay? Devised performance is thus distinguished from scripted theater, that it is completely different from a theater which uses a script. This kind of theater was postmodernist, not only in the way it redefined the procedures and hierarchies of modern theater. So now all the hierarchy, all the foundation that modern theater had laid down was broken. Okay, so it was postmodernist not only because it did that, but also in its radical approach to the question of theatrical representation. Okay, so it had a very radical approach when it came to representation, when it came to pluralism. Whereas it is usually supposed that the function of actors is to represent fictional beings, the performance in radical theaters of the 1960s were often present in themselves. So instead of playing a character, the actors were on stage as themselves, as who they are in original life. Okay, when the performance in the Living Theatre's Paradise Now confronted the spectator saying, "I am not allowed to travel without a passport," was a dialogue that a performer said on the stage. Okay, and "I don't know how to stop the wars," was another dialogue that they said. They were speaking for themselves and not as the character. All right, it was not the character who was making these declarations, but the person, the actor themselves. All right, so you know, these were certain ways in which the foundation of theater was broken down by certain postmodern practitioners, I would say. Okay. In an 1982 essay, Canadian performance theorist Josette Ferral identified this non-representational approach as the key difference between traditional theater and performance art. Okay. It tells of nothing and imitates no one. Performance escapes all illusion and representation. So it's not, there's no script. It's not telling us that look here, now this actor is going to do something, or look there, there is something happening on the balcony of the stage. No, no one is asking you to do anything. The actor is a person, not a character. Okay. So since it's not telling us anything, and since it's not imitating anyone, performance escapes all illusion and representation. There is no illusion anymore. There's no stage anymore. Okay. And there is no representation of what is real anymore. The anti-representational stance of the radical theater and much performance art does indeed distinguish both sharply from conventional theater. So these are what make it entirely different from traditional or conventional theater. Okay, the monologue performances that we talked about earlier are not postmodernist in so far as they present the performer as possessed of a defined and stable identity. So they are not postmodernist. Why? When they are talking about the person who's speaking out, when that person has a defined, stable identity, it is not postmodernist. Okay. But here in this case, the performer appears in his own skin, as his own person, and claims to, you know, do away with the fictional character altogether. That becomes postmodernist. All right. So this is what basically in this section he talks about. So what the audience sees in this kind of a performance is, you know, that the performer who's standing there is someone resembling a real self. Okay. But even then, the identity is not revealed to us. Okay. So this undecidable argument between presentation and representation, okay, is something which is a postmodernist phenomena. What is that? The argument between presentation to what is what we are seeing on stage. Is it a presentation of the actor's self or is it a representation of a character? We don't know. Okay. And this itself is a postmodernist phenomena, right? So this is where this section ends. Moving on to the last, hopefully, section, postmodernist political theater.